During this presentation, you might find yourself wanting to stand up at some point. If you feel that, or when you feel that, I want you to think of the first thing that goes through your mind when you start to think that's what you want to do. Okay? Because one of the really important points that comes from this session is change. How do we actually start to envisage and make change? I'm going to talk about workplace inactivity. I work for a company called Life Fitness. We're a billion-dollar company. We've been focused on fitness for many years, 30-something years. And over the last year and a half, we've been starting to think further outside the box. We're predominantly a product company, but we also see the shift to people rather than things, products. And to do that, we feel that the environment becomes very important, and we also think that digital becomes very important. But most importantly, starting with the human, start with the person, and how do we then help them be more active? Because ultimately, that's what we want to do. So workplace inactivity, it really is an issue. We were meant to move. We heard it in the last session. In fact, their content was very strong in terms of what we ought to be doing, what we were made for. And if you look at the evolution, we started as hunters, we moved to farmers, still very active. Even manufacturing was pretty active. But now we sit in an office, for most of us. And we do it for a long period of time, often 10 hours, 8 hours at our desk. It's really not what we were meant to do as human beings. And there's a lot of physiological things that happen to your body when you do that. I actually think the statistic is fairly flattering, but it suggests that we're sedentary for 21 out of 24 hours. I would argue for a lot of people, actually, it's probably more than 21 hours. So if you just think about your day today, this is probably a good day, because you maybe walk from a train station. You maybe walk between sessions. When you're in the office, often that timeline is much reduced. You move from your bed to sit down for breakfast, probably sit in the car. You get to the office, and then you sit down for lunch. Maybe you walk out at lunchtime, and then you sit in the afternoon. And then if you're lucky, you walk home, or you maybe walk to a train and you go home, and then you sit down in front of the TV with your family, because it's been a tough day, right? You just want to chill out and zone out. So I think 21 is actually quite flattering. I think it's more like 22, maybe even 23. And when you think your body was meant to move, that's not great, is it, really? It doesn't quite work. It turns out that 60% of the population is actually sedentary, considered properly sedentary, as in damaging to your health. So remember what I said, feel free to stand up anytime you like. I did a session in Spain a little while back, and it took me 3 minutes to get the entire room stood up. I'm going to be a little calmer on you today, but I do expect it by the end of this session that you all want to stand up at the back, so feel free. Remember, what is it you think when you first start to think you want to stand up? So these are some of the things that are going on in your body when you're sitting down. But first off, just think about it. When you first go into work, if you thought, this is my end state, right? Pretty much guaranteed, this is where I'm going to end up once I've been working for some time. Would you not think about that at the beginning and say, hang on a second, I'm not entirely happy with that being the end state of me working for 20 years or 10 years, right? Twice the chance of cardiovascular disease. Back problems, hip problems, musculoskeletal issues. See, somebody just starting to sit up. Anytime you like, you can stand up. I need the first person, because once one's gone, everyone goes. High blood pressure, kidney disease. It turns out actually that working out is not enough to solve these problems. If you work out 3 times a week and you still sit down for 8 to 10 hours, it's still a problem. I want you to think about it like this. So think about Niagara Falls, okay? You're canoeing towards Niagara Falls. Just project that for a second. Think about it. There's a point where you can turn round and still paddle away. But if you get too close, there is nothing you can do. You're going over those falls, right? That's what this statement says. If you just sit for all that time, you can't solve it by working out. You've got to do it during the day as well. So think about it from an employee perspective. Where are your costs? Excellent. Number two. Number three. Here we go. We're on a roll. Think about that thing. What was it that stopped you standing up? I want to know that, okay? So think about these. What are your costs in your business? And how could activity change some of those costs? So the easy one for me is musculoskeletal. Anything between 25 and 40%, thank you, of your costs are likely to be musculoskeletal issues due to sitting down. It turns out that 75% of American healthcare costs are caused by lifestyle diseases. 75%. So whilst we're not comfortable yet preventing and putting funding into prevention, the statistics are very clear. And perhaps that's driven by medicine. But you know what? The consumer is starting to change that. They're starting to make their own decisions, like we are in this room right now. So let's think about activity. What is it that we really need to do to be healthy? So the World Health Organization suggests that if we can do 150 minutes of moderate activity a week, we'll be somewhat healthy. So just think about that, 150 minutes. That's not a lot, right? 30 minutes of walking, five days a week, in 10 minute spots. That's not working out, is it? That's walking for the train, right? So just to get a base level of activity, you don't have to do that much. Often it starts by just enabling yourself to do it by standing up when you're ready. If you want even better health benefits, if you can add in 75 minutes of vigorous activity, you will gain from that. I'm not talking about weight loss or anything like that. I'm just talking about physiological benefits to your body. And ideally, you would add in 2 to 3 muscle-strengthening activities a week. So here's the interesting thing. This is pretty much where the fitness industry was created from. Because the fitness industry thought that meant strength machines, right? But actually, it could be swimming. It could be gardening. It could be lifting. It could be, it doesn't have to be in a gym. It just needs to be something that creates or develops strength. So I think we've got to rethink this. This is about making sure we hit a relatively small amount of activity every day, really. So a recent survey from the Future of Wellness, this was a great presentation, this was about a week ago in London, suggested that 75% of people now take more responsibility than they did 10 years ago. That's a big shift. And if you think about consumer-driven healthcare, something we hear about from the US, in essence what it is the person saying, you know what, it's my job. I'm gonna start doing a little bit of this. It doesn't mean they can solve the disease that they might have, but it does mean that they can live better. Just gonna stop before I get in here. What was the thing you thought about just before you got out?
Why not?
Brilliant. Love it. What did you think about
It's better for my body.
Exactly.
Yeah.
One of the things I hear a lot is, I won't tell you. What did you think? No, that's not fair, because you work with me. yes, you were number two, weren't you?
Yeah, if I relate it to the office, it's not normal to stand up. And I think that's the most obvious reason. Often in meetings I say, okay, I'm going to stand up because I'm in meetings all day. And sometimes there's my back is hurting, so there's a reason, and then it's okay. But just to stand up because you feel like it's not really normal to do in the office.
That is exactly it. Our environments are not normal to be active. There'll be a point, by the way, in this room where you guys, and I'm not suggesting you have to stand up, by the way, it's not law, but you might actually start to feel uncomfortable by sitting down. Because the new normal has been standing up. So just watch out for that. So the gear model, what we're saying here is, sitting down is reverse, right? You're actually damaging. You're damaging yourself. If you can just stand up, you start to move forward in first gear. Maybe you can get to walking a little bit, takes you to gear two. Three is maybe a little bit of fast walking, your moderate activity. And four would be getting to that vigorous activity. Okay? So think about it in those terms. We did a study in Mercury Marine, and it gave us a position that suggested that we move from 45% to 92% of somewhat active. So getting to those World Health Organization movement levels, that's a big shift. And look what happens. If you look at the risk on the scale, on the side, low to high risk, you can see where all the risk is, right? That's the sitting down. But look how much you can gain just by getting to walking. You can gain an awful lot just by getting started, right? We don't have to get all the way across to the very active. This may just be too much for the motivation of a lot of people, right? It's like I'm not motivated to learn the violin, but that would be a fifth gear in terms of music for me. So here's an interesting stat. So 47% of a recent survey done by Project Viva in 2017, 47% of the population asked were balance seekers, were keen to be more active, maybe eat better, but wanted it in a balanced fashion. They didn't necessarily want to be going to an intense class, right? They wanted a balanced approach to this. That's a huge number of people when you think about 60% being sedentary. 18% are committed. That's your fitness as a sport people, right? That's the people that go regularly to a gym. Fabulous, absolutely brilliant, motivated. It turns out in a very small sample set, but only a couple of percent are actually balance seekers. They're all much more, yes, I really want to do this. I'm really quite motivated to do this. And in mature markets around the world, we're only at 15% of the population going to a gym. So gyms aren't necessarily, in their current format, going to solve this concern that we have, right? So we did some ethnographic research. And we did ethnographic research because statistically the numbers are already kind of suggesting what we need to know. The real question was, so what do we do? Right? How do we change this? So this was for the fitness industry, but what it's showing here on the scale is from left to right, natural to artificial, from top to bottom, expert to novice. And what we found was that the traditional gym model is very artificial and very expert. But actually, the broader population would be more interested in something that's better suited to the novice and more natural. Makes sense, right? I don't know if you know about boutique gyms, but it's a trend that's happening in the industry. Think about it as the spin studios, for example. Thinking about it as some of the specialist environments, you know, the core CrossFit, those types of things. They're very, very fitness focused. So the industry is actually moving even more towards expert, which is less helpful, actually, to the broader population that we're all interested in. So maybe we actually need to change something at source. And if you think about 50% of the population is employed, maybe that's a good place to start, particularly as productivity is quite an important thing. Not only that, 42% of gym members also use one of those boutiques right now. So fitness as a sport is driving the industry to be even tougher, even harder to get started in. Now, I do think there will be new products, if you like, in that industry. So we're starting to see some active aging products, those types of things. But the industry is currently focused on fitness as a sport, and that's where it's making its money. So what did we learn? Well, we learned there was four key drivers to helping somebody who had maybe tried it and failed in a gym, or had thought about it but had never done it. And those four drivers were, they get a little bit more natural for me. So think about when you were a kid, right? You used to go out, just run around. It was natural. Turns out you've probably done 4 or 5 hours of activity, right? Didn't even think about it. So how do we make it natural? How do we make it something that fits my life, that's normal to me? I'd really like to do it with people. So activate relationships, make it a normal thing. Power walking is a great example of that in a group. Multiple people you can talk to on the way. Think about those relationships. You've got to foster habits, because it turns out the regular piece is the most important piece. Being comfortable standing up is important, right? So foster those habits, and then it's got to fit my life. It's got to fit my everyday life, because you know, I've got kids and they're gonna take me off in a different direction. I'm gonna be driving them around at the weekend to do their thing. And guess what? I'm sitting it down again, right? So it's gotta fit my life. It's gotta be there when I need it. So my question is do we have a corporate activity culture? In this room, do you think your companies have an activity culture?
Still not mature.
Just a little bit more on that?
Yeah, we do a lot, and there's lots of activity. We just have a kind of like everybody's participating. It's random, people do this or that, or they organize things, but it's not everybody's in it, into it. Most people sit. No?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Even when they can stand up, they sit.
Yes, because it's the normal.
Yeah.
So we do see a lot of, it's trying to go, right? It's trying to happen. The question is, how do we move it more quickly and get more deeper into it? So creating that culture is of interest. It's how might we do this? And it turns out that, and this is not factual, because it's still somewhat visionary, but it seems to be that there's four key drivers here. The first and most important is leadership. If your CEO is interested and is driving this, it will be very natural, it will be very normal, and it can start to flourish. If your CEO or your C-suite are not, then it's even harder. It's not normal, right? Normal is working hard, long, to make sure you get things done. Adding a program in is critical, whether that's your own company program or a bespoke program that you purchased in. But having something that connects the interested people, the 47% balance seekers, and giving them something to focus on is really important. If you haven't got an environment that allows that, then you're also going to be struggling a little bit. It's got to be somewhere that is easily active. And lastly, just a couple of little prompts, an active enabler. That might be somebody like me who nudges people to stand up, right? But it could be products or environments or things near where they work that just makes it normal to do something, to get into first gear. Because once you're in first, maybe you get to second. And hopefully that then starts to create a culture of well-being. So what we saw in the study at Mercury Marine was 89% felt an improved sense of job satisfaction. So nothing else changed. But just because I was more active, more comfortable, more helpful towards myself, I was more satisfied with my job. So that starts to lead us towards retaining talent. Starts to connect some of the other key things that we think about in terms of HR. So leadership, just taking an example here. So Jim Radcliffe, CEO of INEOS, he's actively stated, guys, 70 offices around the world, here's 5 packages that you should consider. Depending on the size of your office, go do it. And it's just happening. It's just rolling through the organization. It's a very normal thing, and it's starting to move forward. I say that because to a certain degree, he has done that on this is the right thing to do. I'm going to do it. Rather than return on investment in terms of dollars right here, right now. And I think we're still at that stage. So for example, in the UK, 2% of desks are sit-stand desks. In Holland, I think it's 4%. In Sweden, it's 40%. So when it starts to move, it starts to move. I'm not saying sit-stand desk is the only thing, by the way. It's just an example. So that study from Mercury Marine, 60% had an increased energy level, felt they had an increase in their energy level. Now think about that at the point at which you go home from the office and you now feel energetic and you now feel more happier as a result. You've got a better feeling about the office as well, right, than where you go to work. So programming, I think, is a really important piece of the puzzle. Some companies do their own, but there are starting to be some fairly significant ones that are starting to take shape. Mindvibe downstairs, for example, is an example of that. They start to look at how do we help program the individual to give them a way to track, connect, be excited by activity. But they also then take the data and feed that back into the company to say, what's being used? Who's using it, but how many people are using it? I think we can even get to the point where that data could say 50% of our population is now doing level 2 World Health Organization levels of activity. And then you start to see a shift in how we're doing. So those programs are starting to exist and starting to scale, more importantly. So the research by Future of Wellness suggested that there's a 90% societal shift towards health and fitness. And you can probably feel it, right? It's in the media every day. So I did my quick LinkedIn scan last night. A company called WeWork has just rolled out population gyms across its rental offices. So this is a company that sells office space that's decided that health and well-being and fitness is a way to sell office space. So it's coming. It makes sense in this environment, right? I don't know how many of you were in the CBRE session, but it was really good. It was very good. It basically said, in a nutshell, and correct me if you think I've got this wrong, but let's just recenter on the human being and design around their needs. Because if they're happy and healthy, they'll be more productive. I think in Sweden they've just gone down to 6 hours a day as the norm for working across the country. So they've said the most productive time is 6 hours. Beyond that, and it's too much. I'm not saying that's the right thing, but it's just happened across the country. So we also saw a reduction in pain and discomfort. So think about your musculoskeletal problems in terms of the costs. I was talking to one of our insurer partners actually, and they said 40% of their costs in insuring your employees comes from musculoskeletal issues. So bad back and neck, right? So when you think about your insurer, who's probably trying to reduce the number of appointments per person and the number of people having an appointment, this should start to become important to them. The challenge in that market is it's a highly, highly competitive environment where cost of premium is the most important piece of the puzzle. Look at the US and the increase in self-insured companies is very significant. So for example, Starbucks spend more on health insurance than they do on coffee. Ford spends more on health insurance than steel. So core product costs less than those that produce it. So active enablers, these are things that just get people into that first gear. If you can just go into first gear, I think it was Liz said actually in the last session that they saw people taking this home and then starting to be a little bit more active and fun with the kids when they got home. Let's just think about, how long have I got, by the way, Liz?
You've got 15 minutes.
Sorry,
15 minutes.
Just think about kids for a second. How many people have got kids? Lots of kids. Excellent. No risk in that question, by the way. So just think about it. My kids, I have three kids, and my youngest is 11. She's so simple. Quick check. She's not happy. Got it. Check. That's easy to understand. Food. Done. Check. Okay. Sat too long. We're moving a little bit. Has she run? Has she been out? Lucy particularly, she's like a dog. You've got to run her twice a day or it is a nightmare. We've got a trampoline. It's just outside the back door. Can we do 5 minutes on the trampoline? She comes back in. Super happy. If you think about the human, just connect back to those kids, because all it is with kids is the emotions are so much closer to the surface, right? It's easier to spot. Mercury Marine suggested 56% reduction in stress levels. This is perceived, but perception is pretty important in terms of stress, right? So let's think about that environment. If we think about the two green areas where activity was possible, maybe we should try and do something with the red area, that really difficult area in the middle, right, where we all sit and do what we have to do. I think Treddesk came up in the previous session. I think Liz mentioned that she found the Titan to be a really difficult while she was walking. I agree with you, actually, it's not easy. But what if you took your conference calls on it? Particularly those ones where you're listening for like 20 minutes out of 25, right? You're not going to get breathless any more than I am by wandering around. Think about the swipe left email work that you have to do, right?
Yeah, file.
Yeah, file. You could probably do that from a tread desk, right? So start matching what you use these facilities for. So if we're going to put a tread desk in, we might want to put a banner in that says, this is how you might want to think about using it, as well as why you might use it. So we do need to help it become normal to use these things, right? So this is a really nice drawing that our CAD team have done. It shows a futuristic view of the world. The gym that you see is deliberately not created for the fitness as a sport folk. It's much more created as a place where you can go as a small group and have a walking meeting, for example. It's there, so there's space maybe for yoga as a group. It's more for the 47%. It still looks like a gym because, guess what, it is really. But think about what's on the wall. Think about when you bring a new employee in, the first thing you do is you show them the sit-stand desk and you show them where they can go and have a workout for 20 minutes. It's only 20 minutes. You don't have to do the whole hour. Not sure where the hour came from, by the way. Think about it as they're just going to have a walk for 20 minutes. Come think about your world and what needs doing this afternoon. It also thinks about outside, right? So what about walking trails, or as hotels do now, they give you a map of where to walk when you stay. It's a great way of suggesting activity. It also starts to think about what that office space would look like with enablers in the environment. And I think if we put this together with what we heard from CBRE this morning, I think this would be really quite special. Thinking about those water stations, thinking about the plants, those types of things. So just to close, before before we move on to questions, I think the first and most important thing is sitting disease is real. It's a coined phrase, but in essence, our bodies were meant to move, and we're not allowing them to move. If you think about healthcare costs, activity is a really important piece, physical activity, of your wellness program. So thinking about that gear model, how do we start to get people to gear one, gear two, gear three? How do we get the gear twos to gear three? I think probably most things are focused right now on cost of cure. So if you go to a risk assessment, you end up with, you know, that's how you get it to sound death, right? You go back and you have it assessed and the physio said, maybe we need to make it more available to more people. Think about the World Health Organization standards or suggestions in terms of activity. Let's not think fitness first, right? Because 60% of your population is sedentary, 47% would like to be more active, but don't necessarily have the environment to do it. Most people are ready to take responsibility, and they get that it's their responsibility, and they're starting to make purchasing decisions based on knowing that things are wrong. If you see the growth in healthy foods right now, it's amazing. If you want to invest in something, it's not about that. I didn't suggest that. I'm not an investor, sorry. But if you look at some of these trends, these self-decision trends, they're really quite important. And then I think if you can aim to create that culture of activity, you'll find a lot of things come with it. Because people are more stimulated, they're more interested, they're more up and about, they've got more energy. So other things fall from it. And I don't know if you know about this, when you're in a workout routine or a regular activity three or four times a week, you start to make other choices. You start to drink more water. You start to think about more greens, more fruit. Or subconsciously you do that. Just think about it. Next time you're in a really good sort of activity space, just think about the other decisions that get made almost by themselves. And then finally, in terms of culture, leadership is critical. If your C-suite aren't interested, it's going to be really difficult, really difficult. So that's a group to be very mindful of. And if we think about second session this morning and talking about being an exec director as an HR person, that would be a critical play, I think, in that scenario. Think about programs and think about enablers, just those things that get you off your chair, just like I did at the beginning of this session.